is taken from the book of Romans, chapter 10, verses 9 through 10. If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. Guess what? It's party time. Man, I see some blank looks out there. You know, this is not a normal time of the year when we think about parties. So we kind of associate parties with Christmas and New Year's Eve and birthdays and weddings and retirements and all kinds of things. But yet, in the lives of the followers of Christ, this is the party season. When people have said their loudest, sternest, clearest no, God says yes. At Golgotha, people did their best to say no to God. But on the first day of the week at early dawn, God came back at them and said yes. Nobody expected that. Pilate said no in his hall of judgment. Hastily washing his hands, and the Roman army said no with its public bloody execution. Custom said no with its borrowed grave, sealed with a huge stone rolled in front of it. And the women came to the grave, and their word was a sad no, because they came only to embalm the body of the Lord. Peter and John later ran back to the tomb, but that was because earlier they had gone away and given up, withdrawn, and said no with their feelings. Two on the road to Emmaus said no and left town. They left town because they were disappointed. They thought they had hoped Jesus was the one. You know, and in the upper room, the rest of them gathered and, hiding out of fear and grief, Jesus was gone. They would be next. And theirs was a terrifying no. Unanimously, among friend and foe alike, the word of the hour was no. So when it happened, God's yes. When it happened, nobody was sitting by the graveside, standing by the rock, or even hiding in the near bushes. And God, as he often does because of our dullness and disbelief, came up on their blind side. Hope slipped in and surprised them. So no wonder Easter is the high mark of the Christian year. No wonder churches are crowded Easter morning. What a reason to celebrate. What a party. And look at the guest list. God was so extravagant, he invited us all to the party. You know, you kind of think God would be a little bit more selective, but we are evidence that God will invite anybody. The party was last week. That was Easter. The pews aren't nearly as full today. Resurrection and party life has come and gone. And you know, have you ever been late to a party? You know, I don't really like to be late to a party because when I show up at the party and it's already started, I have no idea what's going on. People are laughing about a joke that I haven't heard yet. It just takes me forever to get caught up. And today is like coming late to a party. We recall some of the excitement of last week, but we're missing some of the enthusiasm, the emotions that we had last week, the elation and the sanctuary that was just filled with people. This Sunday is identified as Low Sunday on the Christian calendar. Low Sunday because it's low in emotion and it's low in numbers. And we might really not notice the difference in numbers if we hadn't all seen what happened last Sunday. So we're going to talk about one of the early disciples of Christ, and he's already been talked about a bunch today, but I hope to show you a little different side here. Thomas missed Easter by a week. He came late to the party. All the others were in the upper room when Christ came among them. And Christ blessed them with shalom, peace to you. He commissioned them with his own ministry. As my Father has sent me, I send you. And he equipped them with his abiding presence and the presence of the Holy Spirit. They really had a party, but Thomas missed it because he wasn't there. Nobody really knows where Thomas was. Where do you think he was? You know, was he off somewhere, caught up in shock and grief, wanting and needing to be alone? There's no real way to know where he was. We are only told where he was not. Thomas was not like in fear with the other disciples in the upper room. But you know, you've heard it this morning. We all tend to blame Thomas for being absent. We blame him because there have been times in our own lives where we have been absent or missed something important. We blame Thomas because he represents all those people we think should be here and are. We blame him because when he was told about the resurrection, he refused to believe it. We consider that incredible. Why wouldn't he believe what the other 10 apostles have told him? Of course, wait a minute. Let's back up a little bit. Thomas was no different than the other 10 apostles. What happened when the women told them about the resurrected Christ? They said it was nonsense. They didn't believe them. That says right in Scripture, Luke 24:11. So why don't we blame the other 10 also? Why just Thomas? We actually know very little about Thomas. Actually, we don't even know his name. He's named after a characteristic. Twin is what Thomas means in Aramaic. Didymus in Greek. So a lot of times he's just simply identified as a twin. He's kind of listed in the middle of all 12 of the disciples. Whether that means he was always in the middle of things or that he was neither stronger or weaker than any of the rest of them, there's no real way to know. His interactions with others give us a little bit of clue about what Thomas was like. Because when Jesus set his face toward Jerusalem, all of the disciples attempted to stop him from going. All except Thomas. It was Thomas who said, "Let us go along with the teacher, so that we may die with him." John 11:16. So does that statement express a sad resignation, or does it express commitment? We don't have a recording of Thomas's voice. We can't tell by his voice what it was, what he was emphasizing. During the last meal that Jesus ate with his disciples, he said that he was going away, and they knew to go where he was going. Well, maybe the rest of them knew, but Thomas didn't. And Thomas was willing to admit it. He even admitted he didn't have the foggiest idea where Jesus was going, much less how to get there. But to me, this makes Thomas a person of integrity. Thomas raised tough questions, the kind that made everyone around nervous, because nobody really knew the answers. None of them thought you ought to admit you didn't know the answer. None of them but Thomas. Thomas refused to silence the integrity of his mind. Faith and reason would be joined for Thomas, or he would know the reason why not. This type of integrity is essential for our emotional, mental, physical, spiritual health. There are plenty of folks around who clearly indicate when it comes to religious matters, don't think about it, just believe. Thomas was one who said that faith was a matter of both the heart and the head. Failure to integrate faith and reason was a breach of integrity for Thomas. It's a sad picture when a person is dishonest with himself and others, struggling to separate faith and reason. Seeking to please others by just saying what they don't believe just because the others went along with it. Thomas refused to take that path because Thomas was a person of integrity. But he was also a person of doubt. We're not going to leave that out. He was a realist. His world left no room for resurrection. When a person was dead, they were dead. He had seen Jesus die, and he would not settle for any hearsay accounts or any secondhand accounts about it. They were just an inadequate foundation for Thomas's belief. In the midst of his doubt, Thomas did not put down the belief of others or attempt to change their minds. He didn't say, "Surely you don't believe that." And he didn't say, "I don't really believe such a tale as that." He didn't say that. He said, "I won't believe this story until I have first seen the scars and placed my finger in those scarred hands and put my hand in that wounded side." That's what he said. And that's important because no person's faith, I'm going to repeat this, no person's faith can rest on another's experience. We benefit from knowing about the journeys of others and what routes they have taken in their development of faith. We appreciate and are strengthened by similarities in our faith sometimes. But we cannot adopt someone else's faith. People have to move beyond the faith of their parents, the faith of their friends, the faith of their teachers, to a faith that is theirs and theirs alone. Otherwise, all they have is a hand-me-down religion. And a hand-me-down religion won't survive the first test that it's put. So, it's difficult to hear and to say this sometimes. Some of us don't have much religion to lose. And what some of us have isn't worth keeping because it's not ours. And you know, when I talk to you, I include myself. We have to hear tough things. We can't always hear good messages sometimes. When the disciples told Thomas about the resurrection, I'm sure there was a part of Thomas that wanted to say, "I believe." After all, 10 close friends couldn't possibly be wrong, could they? But Thomas could not say honestly, "I believe." What he could not say honestly, he would not say, and he would not think it. The believer is not supposed to think, but to believe. However, Thomas was a person of honesty and a person of doubt. He refused to say he believed when he didn't. Please notice there's no record of coercion by the other disciples to force him into a belief. There's no indication that the other disciples rejected Thomas because of his stance or said, "We won't let you be a part of our group unless you believe." Because Thomas, and I think the other disciples also, realized that no one's faith can rest on another person's experience. His faith in God had to be a first-hand experience. This understanding caused another Thomas, many, many years later, Thomas Carlyle, to comment, What we need us to become is a person who knows God at more than second hand." So we said he was a person of honesty, a person of doubt, and a person of conviction. We included that doubt in there. Thomas had been straightforward with his observations about his doubt. But he just needed some first-hand proof. You know, I wonder what his reaction was that week later when Jesus appeared with the disciples and invited Thomas to reach out and touch him. Wow. Thomas must have said, "How did you know I said that?" Thomas had to wonder how Jesus knew. Suddenly, without any touching at all, Thomas no longer needed any proofs. Without even touching him, Thomas exclaimed, "My Lord and my God." Thomas now had faith. Thomas had come late to the party, but he caught up in a hurry. You know, "My Lord" alone. would have been sufficient address for Jesus. It wouldn't have been a magnificent address, really. But Thomas spoke to Jesus as Israel had spoken to Yahweh, "My Lord and my God." These are the last words of a disciple named Thomas that were recorded by John. Thomas had said all there was to say. You know, we've all always berated Thomas, called him the Doubting Thomas. But why have we not given time to the leap of faith expressed in his confession and his commitments and called him Believing Thomas? In the presence of Christ, Thomas's faith was made whole. Seeing was not believing. Commitment came apart from verified proof. Doubt dissolved and his assurance emerged. The honesty of Thomas was still intact. His confession was a statement, a fact. John closed this segment of scripture this way. "These have been written in order that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and through your faith in him, you may have life." Jesus is talking about the readers of the gospel. He's talking about us. The Bible is intended to produce in us the kind of faith that emerged from Thomas. The kind of faith that begins with honesty. Everything is on the table. Faith and reason learn to work together. Questions or no questions are dodged. No convictions are silenced. If doubts arise, so be it. Doubt can be beneficial. As someone once said, doubt is the mother of faith. So you may have come to a genuine first-hand faith in the resurrected Christ in another way. That's great. Celebrate. Celebrate. Maybe Mary Magdalene or Peter or some other is the model for your faith today. But for me, I believe Thomas is a partner and brother in faith. If you still need to come to faith in the risen Lord, don't quit. Don't give up. So you do have doubts and questions. So you are struggling with reconciling your faith and your reason. Take a closer look at Thomas today. He is the patron saint for all who come late to the party.